Good morning, church. Welcome to worship at Bloomington Wesley United Methodist. I'm Pastor Sarah Isbell, and I am so glad that you are worshiping with us today. If this is your first time to worship with us, I want to offer you a special welcome and invite you to stick around after the service to hear the announcements about this week's events, to enjoy our church's 75th anniversary slideshow, and to check out our website, www.wesley-umc.com. If you like what you see, if you want to know more, send us an email at connect@wesley-umc.com. We'd love to hear from you. Now, if you are a regular worshiper with us, I'm sure you're already noticing the new handrails that are being installed this week in the sanctuary to ensure the safety of those going up and especially coming down the chancel steps. You'll remember that the handrails are removable for those occasions when they are not needed. But most of the time, they're going to make these steps a safer place to walk. Today is May 24th, Aldersgate Sunday, or Heritage Sunday in the United Methodist Church. It's a day of some historical significance for those of us who call ourselves Methodists, because it's the day that our founder, John Wesley, had his heart strangely warmed by the grace of God. Now, poor John's bobblehead may not look very warm this morning, but I guarantee you, this is a cool story, and I'm really looking forward to sharing it with you in the sermon. The Wesley family will be appearing in the music as well this morning, because John and Charles Wesley both, his brother, wrote a number of hymns for Methodist worship. The words to today's hymns are printed for you in the PDF that's attached to this bulletin. You may want to follow along as we sing, because the Wesleys wrote these words intentionally to teach our faith. This morning's prelude was written by our own Wesley organist, Andrew Johnson, based on the hymn tune Aurelia by Samuel Sebastian Wesley, grandson of Charles Wesley. If you're a regular worshiper with us, you're going to recognize this piece from several of our special services, including the John Wesley Covenant Renewal. Andrew's arrangement is in four brief movements, each one written to capture the text of the hymn, The Church's One Foundation, which you can read in the bulletin. Andrew was telling me about this hymn, and he said to me, "This was the opening hymn for my very first service at Wesley UMC. It reminds me of God's strong presence here, as evident through the people of Wesley and their united mission." Let's worship God together now, preparing our hearts through this prelude.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Pastor Justin Iverson, and I invite you now into this time of worship with these words. People of God, come now to worship. If you've come joyfully, may your joy be multiplied today. If you've come sorrowfully, may you find comfort and community. If you've come doubtfully, may faith knock at your heart's door. And if you've come unwillingly, stick around for a little while. God may have something to say to you. Would you join me in praying together the words that appear on your screen? Maker in whom we live, in whom we are and move, all glory, power, and praise receive for thy creating love. Amen.
Hello, my name is Andrew Johnson, and I'm proud to serve as organist and chancel choir director here at Wesley United Methodist Church in Bloomington. To me, the most important part of my job is to lead meaningful congregational singing, particularly through the hymns. These hymns are chocked full of scriptural allusions, and each verse serves as a vignette into the Christian experience. Charles Wesley, the brother of John Wesley, for whom this church is named, was the author of many, many great hymns of the Methodist faith. We'll look at two of them today. I'd like to go backwards and start with the chancel choir anthem that we'll hear after the opening hymn. This anthem is And Can It Be, the hymn by Charles Wesley, which I arranged last year in honor of Adria Schumann's retirement, this being her favorite hymn. The poetry wrestles with some personal questions of the nature of God's love for us, as well as outward expressions of praise. And so, as I sat down with this text as I was writing the arrangement, I had to come up with ways of how best to musically portray things such as angels' minds, or chains falling off, or being clothed in righteousness divine. Boldly approaching the eternal throne. And so, as we listen to that anthem in a few minutes, I hope that you might read and reflect upon and be blessed by these words of Charles Wesley. Before that, though, we have our opening hymn, O for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. This text is also by Charles Wesley, and he originally wrote 18 verses. Don't worry, we'll only sing 6 of them today, and they're pretty short. The nature of the first verse, O for a Thousand Tongues, it's not talking about your literal tongue. Rather, it's saying that your single voice, your single person, cannot fully praise God enough. If only you had 1,000, maybe then you would be able to give God his rightful praise. In fact, verse 2 goes on to ask God to help us praise him better. Verses 3 through 5 paint different pictures of the nature of God. For example, he is music in the sinner's ear. Or he breaks the power of canceled sin. And so on. The last verse that we'll sing, verse 7, is the culmination of the experience of God's grace, and it looks forward to his kingdom in heaven. It's uncertain when or how we will next be able to join our 1,000 tongues to sing together. However, it is 100% certain that God is with us now and always. And so, with that assurance, please stand as you are able and join in the singing of O for a Thousand Tongues with as much gusto as you can. Thank you.
Hi, friends. This is Miss Kathy. I'm not going to show you as much of me today as I normally do, but I'm going to tell you a story. There is a video called Clay Ride, A Gallop Through United Methodist History. It's really kind of cool. It tells the story of John Wesley in clay. It's called Claymation. It's kind of old, but it's really good. If you have a chance today, it's about 4 minutes long. And you can learn a lot about John Wesley's life just in that 4 minutes. So if you have a chance, just Google Clay Ride and you'll find it. But I'm going to tell you a different story from John Wesley's life today. I'm going to tell you the story called Plucked from the Fire. John Wesley, we're going to pretend this is John Wesley's house. This wood square right here is his house. And in his house lived his mother and father. They lived down the hall if they were in their bedroom. And then John Wesley had a bunch of brothers and sisters. And they were slept. I don't know if this is what everybody did in that time. But when I read this story, it said that John Wesley and his brothers and sisters all slept in one room together. I made John Wesley a little bit different color so you could pick him out of the rest of the people. I think he was one of the youngest. So they would have been sleeping in the same room called the nursery, kind of like the room at church that we call the nursery. We just have babies in there, and these probably weren't all babies, but they were all kids. I made them a little bit different sizes so you could tell that they're maybe a little bit different in age, but there was a lot of them. And one day when they were all sleeping, a fire broke out in the house. And John Wesley's mother and father must have knew or must have heard or must have smelled that there was a fire because they were able to get out. And then they helped the children get out. I don't know if you guys have ever been in a fire. I bet it's really scary. I have not, but I bet it's super scary. So they helped the children get out. But then Donna Leslie, she noticed, wait, where is John? Where is Jackie is what she called him. We have to get Jackie. We have to get Jackie. But the fire was going really big then. So pay attention to this part. This is one of my favorite parts. So the friends of their family came. They made a human chain up to the house so that they could carry John Wesley over their heads. Kind of reminds me, I like this part because it kind of reminds me of this crazy time that we're living in where our friends help us in different ways. Now, maybe not with a fire, but our friends help us in so many different ways. Maybe we need somebody to talk to. There's so many different ways that our friends can help us in this time where we need our friends. And God gives us friends for that reason, to help in times like this. Another reason I really like this story is because John Wesley and his mother, Susanna, they kind of talked about this fire a lot. They talked about how God must have saved John for some really important work. This story is called Plucked by the Fire. And God must have saved John for some very important work. Just like God is saving us from this virus. Because God has important work for us ahead. We don't exactly know what kind of work that will be. But we know that God will use us. God is going to help us. He's with us. He'll save us. And he's going to give us very important work to do after this is all over. And during this, like the friends, God is going to give us things that we can do to help our friends and things that we can do after this. John Wesley did amazing things in his life, and he was plucked from the fire to do great works. And God is going to use each of you guys to do great works too. I just know it. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for the example of John Wesley. Thank you for this story, and thank you for the great things you're going to do in our lives. We know that you love us, and we love you too. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Bye, guys. Oh, I got one more thing to tell you. Next week, we are going to have a great big birthday party. I can't tell you any more about it, but I want to see you come because we're going to have a great big birthday party. See you next week.
Won't you join me in our time of prayer as we center our hearts? And I'll just encourage you that as I sing through this song, Born Again, that you would think back on your own life and those times where you see God at work, where God moved in you, and you're different and changed because of it. After searching all these years, and the man that I saw, he wasn't at all who I thought he'd be. Well, I was lost when you found me here, and I was broken beyond repair. Then you came along, sing your song over me. It feels like I'm born again. It feels like I'm living for the very first time. For the very first time in my promise to me now. Reassure my heart somehow that the love that I feel is so much more real than anything. I have a feeling in my soul, and I pray that I'm not wrong, I have now is only the beginning. Feels like I'm born again. Feels like I'm living for the very first time. For the very first time. Feels like I'm breathing. Feels like I'm moving for the very first time. For the very first time in my life. Lord, we sit here this morning thanking you for the way your love and grace continues to transform us. We know that your Spirit never stops moving or guiding us as we grow ever more into the people we are called to be. We take comfort in knowing your work in us is not finished. Whether we are just beginning our faith journey or have been on this path for as long as we can remember, we know that there is still so much more to discover in you. When we doubt or find ourselves questioning our faith, we remember that you are still enlightening us and you're not done working in us yet. God, we ask that you would continue to reveal yourself to us so that our hearts may continue to be transformed by your grace. As we look toward you and discover more of who you are, we also reflect on the ways we've already been affected and changed by your love. Whether those moments were life-changing events or simply us responding to little nudges, like attending a church service, we recognize the ways you have moved in our hearts, and we pray this morning that we would continue to recognize you in our daily lives. Lord, we ask all of these things in Christ's name, the one who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
It feels like I'm born again. It feels like I'm living for the very first time. For the very first time. It feels like I'm breathing. It feels like I'm moving. For the very first time, for the very first time in my life.
Have you ever picked up somebody else's mail by accident? You move into a new house and you start getting letters and magazines and ads addressed to the previous occupant. Or maybe you just received something that was not really intended for you. I ordered one item one time, a tool belt, I think, for my brother-in-law, maybe at Christmas, from the Duluth Trading Company, which is a company that sells workwear, like overalls and boots and work gloves, that kind of thing. And now I'm getting their catalog every month for 5 years. Has that ever happened to you? That can be really annoying. Or it can be kind of interesting. One day, out of curiosity, I just started thumbing through the Duluth Trading catalog, and I discovered that they don't only sell workwear now, they also sell activewear. And they've started stocking women's items, too. Running gear? Yoga pants? There just may be something in this for me, after all. Now, I know it's kind of odd to move from yoga pants to the Holy Scriptures, but that's how I want to approach this morning's scripture. From Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians wasn't written for us. It wasn't sent to us. In fact, to be honest, nobody really knows exactly to whom this letter was originally sent. And yet, there just may be something in it for all of us that we can benefit from. Ephesians is presented as a letter from the Apostle Paul to the church at Ephesus. But it really may be a kind of a circular communication written by a follower of Paul to a number of churches around Ephesus, intended to be shared and passed around. The language of Ephesians is kind of flowery and poetic. It can be hard to understand. So just for today, I invite you to hear these words, especially verses 17 through 19, as though they were written for you, as though they were a prayer for you. From somebody who knows you and loves you and believes in you. Hear these words now from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 19. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. I pray this prayer for you and for all of us, that we may indeed know the hope to which we are called and the power of God to accomplish it. Amen. Amen. Today in worship, we honor the history of the Methodist movement and the legacy of its founder, John Wesley. He's back there. John Wesley and his brother Charles are credited with starting the Methodist movement aimed at renewing and rejuvenating the Church of England back in the 18th century and eventually starting up a new denomination here in the States. And of course, Wesley is the namesake for this congregation, Wesley United Methodist Church. John Wesley was an interesting person. I'd like to tell you about him. He was born in 1708 in Epworth, England, the 15th of 19 children, born to Reverend Samuel Wesley and his wife, Susanna. Susanna taught all of her children how to read and write. She taught them Greek and Latin, and she made them memorize major portions of the New Testament. Those of you who have been homeschooling your kids during the coronavirus, imagine doing that with 19 of them, or even just with the 9 Wesley kids who survived past infancy. Susanna took time with each child individually to teach, to correct, to nurture their faith, and to pray. I don't know what prayers specifically she prayed over little John, whom she affectionately called Jackie, but I wonder if she didn't pray something like what we just prayed this morning. Jackie, she might have said, I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. What are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints? And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe? Friends, wouldn't that be a great prayer to pray over our own kids? Well, whatever she prayed, it apparently worked. Miss Kathy has shared with us today the story about how little Jackie was saved from a house fire when he was only 5 years old, a brand plucked from the burning, his mother called him after that. She believed that he had been spared for some very special purpose. And in fact, today is a good day to appreciate what God did accomplish through this little boy when he became a man. When John Wesley graduated from boarding school, he went to Oxford University to study for holy orders in the Church of England. His younger brother Charles came along behind him, and soon they founded a little group of students, a campus ministry, if you will, dedicated to holy living. Now, they were not particularly popular among their classmates. In fact, other students disparagingly called them the Holy Club or the supererogation men. Supererogation just means over the top, above and beyond. And they called them Bible moths because they spent so much time studying the scripture, starting each day at 6 a.m. and studying for 3 hours with prayer before starting on their schoolwork. The Bible moths developed a highly structured lifestyle aimed at holiness, faithfulness to scripture, and pleasing God, including fasting twice a week, Holy Communion once a week, regular tithes and offerings, and constant prayer. Soon they added to their calendar visiting the sick and imprisoned, teaching the gospel to street children, giving whatever they had to those in need. Now, I don't know if you can imagine a group of college students dedicating themselves fully to living as Scripture commands, but that is exactly what these young men did. They held each other accountable to these strict and holy methods of living, and they made such an impression, other students started calling them Methodists, a name that eventually stuck. I wonder, how many of us have thrown ourselves into holy living and faithfulness like these early Methodists did? It's kind of intimidating, isn't it? I mean, we say in worship that we love the Lord our God with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind and all our strength. And yet, when we look at their example, we're kind of humbled, aren't we? I mean, I don't know about you, but I'm not living that way. Fasting twice a week, constant communion, 3 hours of Bible study a day, visiting people in prison and helping pay their bond with my own money. I don't know how a person could live like that today and still hold down a job, or raise a family, or enjoy any hobbies, or hold any kind of balanced lifestyle at all. And maybe that was Wesley's problem, lack of balance. Because as the years went on, he became increasingly preoccupied with his own faithfulness and holiness. He became more and more worried that he wasn't measuring up. Wesley started keeping a journal, not just of what he did every day, but of his constant efforts toward perfection, spiritual perfection. He developed a kind of 18th century spreadsheet to help him keep track of his spiritual disciplines and even his attitudes, ranking his own temper of devotion every hour on a scale of 1 to 9. Here are just a few of the 22 questions he asked himself every day. Am I honest in all my acts and words? Can I be trusted? Am I self-conscious, self-pitying, or self-justifying? Did the Bible live in me today? Did I disobey God in anything? And is Christ real to me? Would you want to ask yourself these questions every day? If I'm honest, I don't think I want to know myself that well. I'm not even sure I want God to examine me that closely. So it may or may not surprise you to learn that all this religious rigor did not make John Wesley happy. It did not make him feel more loved and accepted by God. It didn't even deepen his faith. In fact, Wesley was becoming a deeply unhappy Christian. Have you ever had that feeling? Like the harder you work, the farther behind you fall? Some of his efforts were failing miserably. Some of his relationships were strained and stressful, and his constant efforts to judge what counted as a Christian lifestyle alienated him from other people that he didn't think were trying hard enough. In fact, as Wesley preached in pulpits around London, his message regularly offended people. He kept getting kicked out of church after church because his preaching was too intense. His message was too demanding. He made people uncomfortable. Wesley began to consider giving up preaching altogether. Fortunately, he confided first in a friend, Peter Baylor, that he was thinking about giving up preaching since he was having trouble believing his own words. He wrote about this in his journal in March of 1738. And Baylor advised him not to give it up, but to preach faith until you have it. And then because you have it, you will preach faith. That's interesting advice, isn't it? Act like you believe it, and maybe one day you will. I wonder if that advice would work for any of us when we have days of doubt and struggle. And I don't just mean fake it with others and you'll fool yourself too, but live the life you wished you believed in. And see if that living doesn't bring you closer to where you want to be. One night in May, a friend invited Wesley to attend an evening prayer meeting. And that meeting changed everything. Here's what he wrote in his journal. In the evening, I went very unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate Street where one was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle to the Romans. And about a quarter before 9, while he was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ alone for salvation. And an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. That moment, May 24th, 1738, 282 years ago today, is now known as Wesley's heartwarming experience and the true beginning of Methodism. One of the most important lessons John Wesley learned that night on Aldersgate Street is that you can't earn God's love. Working harder doesn't do it. Praying longer doesn't do it. All the good deeds in the world don't earn God's love, because God gives love away for free. Your job is just to receive it and then let it change you. It's what the church calls grace. It's what John Wesley was known for. It's what Methodism is still known for, relying on grace for God's saving love. Now, a lot of Wesley's teaching and practice are still with us today, though most of us are not living according to that spreadsheet. But the focus on grace, forgiveness of sin, redemption toward a new life, spiritual formation through small group ministry and prayer. When we look back at 18th century John Wesley, we can recognize ourselves. But here's what I wonder. If 18th century John Wesley could catch a glimpse of us, would he recognize himself and the movement he started? Especially in today's crazy season of online worship and video devotions and Facebook evangelism and committee meetings by Zoom, what would he think of all this? Well, I don't know how comfortable John would be with all of us who are worshiping in our jammies this morning. And let's be clear, I'm recording this sermon on Thursday in the sanctuary in my church clothes, but on Sunday morning when we're all listening to worship together, I'm snuggled up with my cat and my cup of tea in my recliner just like you. John Wesley might be a little unsure about the relaxed way we're doing worship these days, and the fact that none of us, myself included, know how to read the Bible in the original Greek. He might advise us all to pray more than we do, to study scripture more than we do, to be more intentional about our spiritual practices. After all, Wesley kept his strict schedule and maintained his methodical ways until the day he died. But Wesley also reached well beyond the regulations of his day in the name of sharing the gospel with anybody he could in any way he could. It took him a while, to be sure, to get over his supererogation and obedience to all the rules. But with his heart strangely warmed and with grace making a home in his soul, Wesley began to reach out and try new things, like preaching not in a pulpit, but out in the open field. He called it submitting to be more vile. But what it really meant was men who worked 24/7 in the mines, who couldn't go to church, got to hear the gospel anyway because Wesley brought it to them. He let lay people and even women preach in Methodist circles. Because after all, his mother was a lay woman and she taught him everything he knew. He even ordained some preachers himself, which was totally against the rules. But he did it because the Church of England wouldn't send any priests over to the American colonies, where the Methodist movement was growing. For a rigid rule follower and Orthodox Christian, he broke way out of the box when there were souls to be saved and sinners to be redeemed. Because of God's amazing love for him, he wanted to share amazing love with everybody he could reach, no matter how vile, and no matter what it took. So, despite the jammies, I think John Wesley would be proud of Bloomington Wesley today. Because we've figured out how to get the gospel out beyond our own sanctuary and into your living room. We've found ways to gather people for prayer on Sunday evenings and for small group study by Zoom on Thursday afternoons. We have even figured out how to become for our neighbors the church of the toilet paper and the diapers. And if that's not submitting to be more vile, I don't know what is. Strange times call for strange methods. But then, that's what the word Methodist really means. But our reliance on God's grace and our prayers for one another to grow in faith remain the same, even after 282 years. That's an amazing heritage, friends. And I'm so pleased and proud that we get to share it together. Now, I ask you at the very beginning of this sermon to listen to the words of the scripture from Ephesians as though they were a prayer being prayed for you, that you would receive a spirit of wisdom and revelation, that you might know what is the hope to which you've been called, and the richness of your inheritance, and the greatness of God's power for those who believe. That's the prayer that I suspect Susanna Wesley prayed over her son, the prayer that helped get this Methodist church started. So now I wonder if I could ask you just one more thing as we close. I want to read the scripture to you one more time. And again, I invite you to hear it as a prayer. But would you this time picture somebody else in your mind? Maybe somebody who, like Wesley, is trying too hard, trying to earn God's love. Or somebody who is struggling with doubt and is ready to give up. Or somebody who's searching for their calling, wondering what it is God wants them to do. Or maybe you want to hear it as a prayer for yourself, in whatever circumstance you find yourself, that you would encounter the God who is on fire in love for you, and that your own heart might be strangely warmed. I invite you to bow with me. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened and your heart strangely warmed, you may know what is the hope to which he's called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe. Amen. Amen. I have a quick announcement as we move on with our service. It has been really exciting and energizing to find new ways to get the good news about God's grace and the ministry of Wesley out over the internet. If you are worshiping with us through the miracle of modern technology, I want to thank you for your flexibility and your willingness to try new things. And I also want to thank Kendra Bull, our Director of Communications for almost 2 years here at Wesley, for her excellent work. Kendra's creativity and enthusiasm have been an incredible blessing to Wesley Church and have really helped us launch our online ministry in ways that I think would make John Wesley proud and don't seem vile at all. Well, Kendra is hearing a new call these days to a different kind of service in our community. And so she'll be leaving our Wesley staff, though not leaving Wesley Church, for a career in realty. The Staff Parish Relations Committee is working on an updated job description that takes into account the changing needs of a changing world, just like John Wesley did. And so we'll be looking for someone this summer. If you or someone you know has particular gifts for digital communication or even video work, would you send us an email at connect@wesley-umc.com. In the meantime, our current staff will be covering the tasks of the communication position and keeping the good news coming your way through email, Facebook, website, and good old-fashioned post. We appreciate your prayers for Kendra and her family, for the committee, and for all churches everywhere learning new ways to share the love of Jesus Christ in and out of quarantine. Thank you, Kendra. And thank you, Wesley.
And now for a chance to respond to God's generosity in our own lives by giving of our tithes and offerings. Thank you to everyone who has so generously continued to contribute to Wesley UMC during this season. Your gifts are greatly appreciated and are going a long way to keep the church fully staffed and our ministries fully operational during this time. Because today is Heritage Sunday, we want to specifically acknowledge the generosity of Wesley's congregation throughout our history. The gifts you've given have not only aided in the building and upkeep of our incredible facility in downtown Bloomington, but they've allowed us to expand our outreach capabilities through the purchase and redevelopment of the property now known as Wesley West. While we're not presently worshiping together inside our church building, expenses do continue. Expenses like regular electric and water bills, and even some special construction projects, like refinishing the steps at the front of the sanctuary. These ongoing bills and special maintenance projects would not persist without your incredible generosity. In addition to the maintenance of our facilities, Wesley Church continues to offer weekly worship experiences, frequent Bible studies, and regular opportunities for spiritual development of our children, youth, and adult populations. COVID-19 has changed many of the ways that we offer these ministries by forcing us to move them online. We've incurred new expenses related to internet, online communication like Zoom, and special licenses granting us permission to broadcast music over the web. Thank you for continuing to fulfill your pledged gifts so that we can continue to adapt our ministries to meet the changing world around us. If you'd like to contribute to Wesley Church, please log on to www.wesley-umc.com/give and look for our Give Plus app. You may also send any contributions via mail to 502 East Front Street, Bloomington, Illinois, 61701. We are safely able to receive mail during this time. Thank you again for your ongoing generosity and your faithfulness. God, help us to continue using these financial blessings that you have given to us so that we might be a blessing for the world around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for joining us for online worship today. We're so glad that you've spent some of your Sunday with us. Before we go, we'd like to share a few details about upcoming happenings at Wesley Church with you. Because today is Heritage Sunday, we want to share with you a few of our memories from Wesley Church over the last 76 years. If you're on the YouTube website, you can look for a section of text right below this video. We call this the description box, and each time the church releases a video, you'll find relevant information about that video in that box. For example, on Sunday morning, you can easily find a link to the bulletin located in the description box. For this particular video, because it's Heritage Sunday, you'll also find a link to last year's 75th anniversary photo compilation. We invite you to take a look at these photos again to reminisce about all of the blessings that God has provided for and through Wesley Church throughout its history. Next week is Pentecost Sunday, so don't forget to wear red. But to celebrate, we're inviting families to come to Wesley West between 12 and 2 p.m. next week to pick up their Pentecost party in a bag. Miss Kathy will, using appropriate social distancing, distribute these bags to any family that wishes to pick one up next Sunday. Also, don't forget that Ali Akyus is creating a special presentation for next week's worship service. He's calling this presentation The World Ablaze, and it's a photo compilation project that he is creating for the worship service next week. Take a moment to look through your photos and submit images of how God is active in your life using the link in the description box below. Finally, don't forget to find a way to prepare for Pentecost with your family this week. The birthday of the church is something certainly worth celebrating. So take some time this week to decorate your front door, maybe, or hang red balloons, maybe have a bonfire in your backyard, or even hang a wind chime to celebrate the movement of the Holy Spirit in your life. God is so faithful to his church. Let us get ready for next Sunday's celebration of Pentecost by celebrating the church's birthday a little bit early this week. And now, let's close our time together by sharing in a moment of blessing one another. Would you turn to someone in your house and share with them these words, God bless you and keep you. If you're on your own today, feel free to call a friend and offer the same blessing to them. So church, God bless you and keep you. We'll see you next time.